Today we're going to be spec 2. This is a new Grady boost control that just came out. It's similar to the older Profect Bii, but the good thing about this unit is it actually reads boost in PSI instead of kilopascal. Install shouldn't be too difficult. This consists of the head unit and the actual solenoid. You have your harness. First thing we're going to do is take the car apart. Now we're going to take this whole bezel off, and there's two screws hitting under here, which is kind of a pain to get to if you have low lighting. Use a second vent hole in the bottom, it's easier to get to the screw. Right, we got the screws out finally. Next thing you want to do, you want to remove these little buttons. Sometimes they're pretty, you got to use two hands to take them out. Or you can use a pair of pliers. If your buddy's not looking, you can use the pliers and take them out. But this is the cameraman's car, so you can't use that right now. I usually use two hands, and with two hands I pull on it. Right, now that we got these off, just tug on it. Voila. Look for the screws in the back. They usually hang out in the bezel. This plastic piece here, pull down on it, tug back. Voila. If you purchased your car with the low jack, it's probably in there. You didn't hear that from me though. Remove the defogger panel. This little slot we're going to be installing the Profect Bii Cruiser. That's where they have their cruise control set up. Now we're going to run the power for the actual part for the unit. We're going to run it to the fuse box and we're going to tap it off the wiper fuse. There's actually two wires on the wiper fuse. Take off the fuse box, two screws. This here's the fuse box. Take the two screws, it comes off. On the back you have two blue wires, which is going to position number 2 with the 20 amp fuse. These are going to your wiper motor. Take the red line, cut it. Make sure you have enough slack so you can mount the head unit. Strip the wire. The wire on the one of the wires on the wiper motor for the wiper, wrap it around, soldering on. This particular unit doesn't come with a crimp on the end like the turbo timers do, but But if you have a turbo timer, you can actually piggyback this onto this unit. You can solder it on, or you could cut it and wrap it around a bolt, tighten it down, of course.
Yeah, right.
But if you're installing any type of fuel computer that works on small AC signals, you want to physically get your own ground for that unit. So here we're going to go off the ground for the turbo timer. After you're done with this, you want to make sure you tape it. Use a good black tape, or you can use this aircraft grade tape if you get it. If you don't have access to a soldering, the best thing to do is solder it. If you don't have access to a soldering iron, you can use one of these blue splice taps. But I wouldn't recommend this one on this because it's kind of a small gauge red wire. Small gauge and a thick gauge wire, you don't get a good crimp using these pieces. And sometimes they do come apart if you have two different size gauges on it. So I suggest you solder it on if possible. You want to take this nut back here off, this screw, and use it as the anchor point for the actual ground. You don't want to use the one off the fuse box because you may get a bad ground. If you don't have a turbo timer, you can always use just the wire itself. And wrap it around. You want to put it in this way, so when you tighten it, it goes with it. If you do it the opposite way, when you tighten it, it actually takes it off the screw. And then just put all this back together the way it was. There's a lot of room back here. You can put pretty much anything back here. I got my E-Manage and my Greddy EO1 brain back there, so there's a lot of space. The intake pipe pretty much is a screw here, and it comes out. Now when you take it off for the first time, you want to use like a big massive screwdriver like this and kind of wedge it in there and twist it, that way you can have it pop out. And actually, this is the only thing you want to do with the car actually warm, because when it's warm, it's actually, it's a little easier to get off. When it's cold, it's a lot more difficult. Now the hardest part of the whole install is running all the cabling. Actually, not much, but just the wires through the actual firewall. Now, I've been looking, and I'm yet to find a good grommet in here somewhere where we can actually use to get the, to run the hoses through. So what I end up doing is, this fat hose here, this fat cable harness, this goes into the, through the firewall. There's a big, fat grommet on it. Now, I've tried using a coat hanger to run one wire through, but for this install we're using a lot of different wires and the connectors are big, so I can't get away with that setup. So what I have to do is I have to take the big screwdriver, put it on the actual grommet, and we're going to push the grommet into the car like so. Now you can actually see some light from inside the car. Now what we're going to do is we're going to go to the back of that grommet with a blade. You're going to cut the side of it, careful not to damage any wires. Then you're going to run all your wire through that grommet. Once you have your wire through the grommet, you pull it out some, and then you run it through the firewall. Then pull it through the firewall, pull it through, then put the grommet back in. And that's the hardest part of doing all these boost controllers. Pain in the butt. Here's the solenoid, here's the connector to the solenoid. See how it goes. Now you want to run this piece through the firewall. Don't run this one, because then you'll kick yourself in the butt, because it'll be on the other side, on the wrong side. You have to take it out, and do it. And once you take this apart, you rattle it. You're going to pull a grommet, cut a slit, run this through a grommet, pull it, then fish this inside. What I'm actually do is you can take a piece of coat hanger, tape it to this, run the coat hanger through the other side, and you can fish it through. We're going to use that to run this, and also the vacuum hose. Actually, we might get away with not using needing a coat hanger. We can just bundle it in there. But if you have a small, fine wire, you're going to need a coat hanger to run it through. Here's your solenoid again. If you look at it, you're going to notice that there's three caps on it. You want to remove all three caps. Unlike myself, I only removed two, and I wasn't boosting right. So you want to put these fittings on the comm port and the port that says no. Now on the back of the solenoid, there's another fitting. It says NC on it. We're not going to use that one. Later on, if you ever get my single turbo kit, it's coming out. I'm not sure when, but hopefully this year, 2003. It's an external wastegate. You can utilize this fitting for the external wastegate. It won't work the way it is now on an external wastegate. We're very limited on space on this car, as far as where to mount stuff. But here I mounted a solenoid right on the airbox. Using a 5/16 or an 8mm socket, you remove the bolt from here. Take the whole bolt out, and you put the solenoid in. When you're mounting the solenoid, it has a little plate that has two screws on it. Mount the plate, comes the rubber grommet. The rubber grommet has to go on the bolt that you're going to bolt from the vibration, so you can have longer life on the solenoid. Now, if you look back here, we have two pressure sources coming from the turbo. We have this green one here, which is for the stock solenoid. You don't want to touch that. And we have another one here, which goes to the purge tank. That's what we're going to go for, the purge tank.
Hey, Bridget.
We disconnect this hose off the pressure source there. And what we're going to do is, we're going to take a piece of the... This hose comes with the boost controller. There's two sizes. The smaller gauge goes into the manifold. So the Profect Bii will have a pressure source. This one here is for controlling for the actual boost. Anyways, you take a piece of this here, cut about maybe 3 inches worth. Get a vacuum, see? This vacuum tee is not supplied with the kit. I guess if I have some in stock, I guess I'll ship some out. This is a 1/4-inch size. Hook it up like so. Hook it up here. And connect it back to that pressure source. Now we're going to route this hose from here. Route it from there, and we're going to connect it to the NO portion. When you install it, try not to get a kink in the line, so you don't restrict any air going through it. Next, take off the factory hose from the wastegate actuator, which is a pain in the butt to take off. Any day now. an hour later, taking off this hose. Use the other end from the supply kit, the quarter inch line, hook it up to the wastegate, and hook it up to the comm side. Now the stock hose here, we're going to have to cap it off. The back of the throttle body. There's two pressure sources here. One is coming off the oil catch can, which we installed. But you don't want to go there because you might have some residual oil in there still. You don't want any of that oil going into the system inside, into the actual Profect Bii. So what we do is we disconnect, we use a second pressure source, which is right here. We disconnect the plastic hose from here. We use a supplied triangular fitting here. Another extra piece off. A lot of times they don't supply enough vacuum, so you might have to get some at the auto parts store. Let's route this back to this. Had to make it a little long here, so we don't want to kink hose. See the vacuum line where we routed it through. We want to do a nice installation and then run the clamps to make it more coolant. Ran it behind the battery, tap it in here. The harness. Run under here. Just a connector. Tuck it in there. Out of sight, out of mind. That's pretty much the whole installation as far as the vacuum side. So to cover everything, to go back through what we did. We got this vacuum line here going inside to the actual Profect Bii. We run it here to a pressure source coming off the throttle body. So this is going to read boost. This is how the Profect Bii reads boost, and it knows how to control the solenoid. Took the vacuum line, ran it right off the wastegate, directly into the comm port on the control valve. Go from the NO portion. This is a pressure source, another pressure source. We could have used this one here, but there's actually higher pressure at the turbo than there is here, because you got some type of a drop through the intercooler. So for a quicker response, hook it up back here to the pressure source coming off the turbo. There's two nipples. We went off the one with the blue line. We teed off the blue line. Leave the green line alone. Once it's all installed, go back and install your intake pipe. We're pretty much done with the installation. Ran the wires, two harnesses and one vacuum line. Here's the power. And this one here is for the actual solenoid. And here's the vacuum. Right through under the car, under the dash. Drilled a hole in the defogger panel back. Now when you install this, you want to pull on it and you want to make sure all the wires on the bottom are secure. You want to apply use some tie wraps. There's nothing worse then shifting. Been there, done that. Now you want to take the unit, put some double-sided tape under it, and install it like so. All right, so we pretty much have the whole install done. Now just put the tape on and remove it from the back. This is another 2-hour process, like the firewall. slide it in. There you go. Now we're ready to go blow up some stuff. You don't want to run more than 15 pounds. Actually, we did the ED spring mod, and we're holding 15 pounds to red line, but you don't want to go above that. Just to keep it, you know, be conservative. Don't go too crazy. Now we're gonna go try it out. See if we can blow it out. Here we have a filter. This comes with a kit. You want to install this in line with the hose going into the actual Profect Bii unit. Now this car here, you might get some sputtering. This car, the ECU setup is actually different than mine, and the car doesn't like to see the boost. So what's happening is the stock surge valve is opening and closing, which is right there. It's opening up and venting the extra boost, so it's fluttering and the boost is coming back and forth. So what we did was we installed a check valve. Here's your check valve. Air flows one way, that way, but doesn't flow back the other way. So when you have air on the surge valve, it's keeping the surge valve closed. When the stock solenoid opens up, it's supposed to relieve that pressure, so the solenoid opens up and you vent air out. That's how the ECU helps control boost. But with the stock check valve in place, the solenoid can no longer control the boost, and you will have no fluctuation in your boost when you set it with your boost control. You can use a check valve, or you can go block the place they have there that block off the stock surge valve location. Here's my assistant. Assistant there in a little bikini. Got muscular hands there. That's pretty much it. That's the whole install. Took about a good hour and a half or so. But if you have any questions, shoot us an email at sales@exhaustdepot.com, and we'll be happy to answer your questions. All right, have a good one. Bye.